as Kinga mentioned, I'm interested in circadian rhythms. And I was very glad that in 2017, two scientists working on Drosophila were awarded with Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine, Jeff Hall, Michael Rosbach, and Michael Young. What they have found? They just discovered a molecular, I hope that it will work, because this is a short animation, showing how molecular mechanism of the clock work. So the molecular mechanism is based on transcriptional, translational feedback loops, positive and negative. And in Drosophila, two main clock genes, PER and TIM, are expressed at certain time of the day and night. Actually, PER and TIM are expressed at the end of day, beginning of night. And later, during the night, proteins, PER and TIM, clock proteins, are synthesized. They form heterodimers, enter the nucleus, and inhibit transcription factors which are responsible for expression of PER and TIM genes. So actually protein inhibits on gene transcription. And this is on and on until, for example, what is important in the regulation of this process is cryptochrome, is in abbreviation CRY. This is circadian photoreceptor, and CRY, when light is on, degrades by binding TIM, and when TIM is degraded, the inhibition is finished, and the next cycle can start. And this mechanism is, of course, more complicated. And there is many feedback loops, but I will not concentrate on them. But would like to also mention that in mammals, the mechanism of the circadian clock is very similar, but main clock genes are not PER in TIM, but PER, several PER, PER1, PER2, PER3, and CRY, CRY1, CRY2 in mice, and they also control first proteins are synthesized, and protein forming heterodimers control expression of on genes. So the similar mechanism and also changes during the day and night. I don't know if this animation can be, yes, you can see expression of genes and proteins are formed during the day, and the heterodimers, they enter the nucleus and inhibits transcription factors, and this is it's happening, this inhibition during the night, and as soon as clock proteins are degraded, the inhibition is finished, and the next cycle can start. And this is the self-maintaining, self-generating mechanism. And also this clock controls several genes which are clock control. So they don't belong to the mechanism of the molecular clock, but they are control, the cyclic expression is controlled by the molecular clock. I study circadian rhythm in the brain using two models. One model is the visual system of flies, mainly Drosophila. And another model are mice. And here you can see the eye of Drosophila. This is the compound eye composed of 800 single unit called omatidia. And the visual system, this is horizontal section through the visual system. comprises the retina of the eye and also parts of the brain which are called optic neuropi. And this first one is called lamina, second medulla, lobula, and lobula plate. And of course, is even this system is quite simple, it's not possible to study all neurons and also glial cells which are in the nervous system. So cross section through the lamina here shows again modular structure of this first optic neuropile and single modules called cartridge, and only cross section of this cartridge shown on this cartoon just shows several types of neurons which are inside inside a single cartridge which we study. Photoreceptor terminals and one postsynaptic cells in tetrad synapses that are shown here, and glial cells surrounding every cartridge. And what is important that visual and photic information are transmitted from photoreceptor just in this area. There are photoreceptor terminals here to postsynaptic cells. There is four postsynaptic cells, and L2 is one of them. And this synapse is called tetrad and has this presynaptic specialization, which is called T-bar. And L2, a monopolar cell, this postsynaptic cells also form synaptic contact with photoreceptor terminals, and T-bar is in these cells. And glial cells just surround every cartridge. I have found long time ago that the number of synaptic contacts oscillate during the day and night, and feedback synapses, there is more feedback synapses during the night, but tetrad synapses, they show reverse pattern, and there is more feedback, more tetrad synapses during the day. And this observation was in the housefly lamina. In addition, I found the cross-sectional area of axons L1 and L2. So these neurons are postsynaptic cells in tetrad synapses, and they swell during the day and shrink during the night. Next, we wanted to detect if this rhythm is only present in the housefly, or maybe other fly species also show oscillation in size of neurons and in the number of synaptic contacts. And we used Drosophila and found that also L1 and L2 monopolar cells, this first order interneurons, which receive input from photoreceptors of the eye, if they oscillate inside. So they do. But the pattern is a little bit different, and they swell a little bit at the beginning of day. And this is ZT, means Zeitgeber time. This is the ZT0, means beginning of day, and ZT12, beginning of night. So when flies are examined at the beginning of day, they we notice the L1 and L2 axons were swollen, shrunk later during the day, swollen again at the beginning of night, and shrunk during the night when fly actually sleep. In Drosophila, it's also possible to study structure of neurons when in transgenic flies green fluorescent protein is expressed. Green fluorescent proteins is GFP, and this protein can be expressed in photoreceptor, in L2 monopolar cells, interneurons, and in glial cells, and the red dots are just antibodies used against synaptic protein with BRP, which is main protein building presynaptic element, this T-bar. And we found that in addition to changes in size of axons of L1, L2 monopolar cells, there are also changes in nuclei of cells. And when flies are fixed at different time of the day at night, so this is ZT0 beginning of the day, ZT13 beginning 1 hour after lights off. So we see the nuclei in males and females, they change size during the day at night. In addition, we found dendritic tree. And dendritic tree, this is the extension of dendrite from axons. They also change morphology during the day at night. And the dendritic tree is larger during the day than during the night. So when flies are active, dendritic tree is more, dendrites are longer, is more complicated, but when flies sleep, dendritic tree is reduced and dendrites are shorter. And we examine also in details in the proximal part of the lamina size of L2 axons, and here you can see that L2 axons in the proximal lamina are largest at the beginning of day. This rhythm is maintained under constant darkness, but is abolished under constant light. And this is true to most circadian oscillators. The constant light stops cycling of endogenous oscillators. And of course, we use also clock mutants. This is per null mutant. So in this mutant, there is no per protein, no this clock protein. And we found that when this clock protein is not present, this rhythm in changes of L2 axons size is not maintained. In another mutant, CRY-B, this rhythm is changed. So this pattern is not the same like in wild-type flies. If we see changes in neurons in size and shape, it means that we don't know what it means. It means that the brain is swelling and shrinking at certain day at certain time during the day. And we found that this is not true because glial cell offset changes in neuron. So when neurons are swollen, glial cells are shrunk. And here you can see the glial cells between cartridges, and also they make processes coming between neurons in every cartridge. There are also invagination inside cartridges. They are called inside photoreceptor terminals. They are called capitide projections, and this and they are very important in recycling neurotransmitter in tetrad synapses, which is histamine. So glial cells, glial cells are shrunk when neurons are enlarged. So when the axons are enlarged, so glial cells are shrunk. So it means that brain at the beginning of day, in case of Drosophila, is not enlarged because at the same time glial cells are shrunk. We also express different type of genes, clock genes and clock control genes in both cell types, in interneurons and also in glial cells, to see if these types of cells are small oscillators. Small oscillators means that if they express clock gene in a circadian mode like clock cells, and we found that L2 are not oscillators because they express pair gene, but actually expression is not in the same pattern like in clock cells. So probably pair plays another role in L2 neurons, but a pattern typical for circadian oscillators was found in glial cells, and also different types of clock control genes that differently express in two cell types, but only genes coding PDF receptors, and PDF receptors are responsive to PDF, pigment dispersing factor, which is a neuropeptide, and also neurotransmitter in the circadian clock. So probably they receive both cell types information via PDF receptors and stimulated by neuropeptide by PDF, by this neurotransmitter, the circadian clock neurotransmitter. Going back to synapses, in Drosophila, we found that BRP is building this this presynaptic elements T-bar, and antibodies which I mentioned already against BRP just bind to C-terminal of this protein. And here you can see the labeling of the whole lamina, cross-section of the lamina with antibodies showing synaptic signs. We found that in Drosophila, the number of tetrad synapses also oscillate, and there are two peaks, one at ZT1 and one at ZT13. But this protein, BRP, is composed of two isoforms. And if only one isoform of BRP is expressed, this disappears. So circadian cycling of tetrad synapses needs two isoforms of BRP. We also examine synaptic vesicles. So synaptic vesicles are filled with neurotransmitters, and they come close to the platform of the presynaptic terminal T-bar. And they are delivered to the presynaptic membrane, which is here, to be released into synaptic cleft and transmit information to the postsynaptic cells. So we found that the number of synaptic vesicles is very similar during the day at night. Here are synaptic vesicles during at the beginning of day when flies are very active, and in the middle of night when they sleep. So a little more synaptic, a little bit more synaptic vesicles we have observed during the night, maybe because accumulation of synaptic vesicles just to be ready for release at the beginning of day when light is night. So even there is more synaptic vesicles during the night, they are not attached during the night to the presynaptic platform. And this is the EM electron microscope tomography showing that there is lots of synaptic vesicles attached to the platform of T-bar, and this is the presynaptic membrane of synapse. And but during the night, even in total, there is more synaptic vesicles. They are not attached to the presynaptic cycle, so platform. So again, another example of circadian oscillation daily under day-night condition, but under constant darkening circadian oscillation in neurons. In addition, we found that presynaptic protein BRP also oscillate during the day at night, and there are two peaks, exactly like in the number of tetrad synapses at the beginning of day and at the beginning of night. But under constant darkness, there is one peak, because we think that this first peak is regulated by light, but the second one by the circadian clock. We found the changes in BRP level during the day and night depends on cry. And our studies on interaction between BRP and cry protein, as you remember, the cry is a circadian photoreceptors, is also degrading in the same way, probably like is degrading TIM protein, but in case of synapses, they probably make contacts with BRP, and we know the complexes are during the day or under light conditions, and because of degradation, the level of BRP is decreased during the night. And this project has been done in collaboration with Professor Ezio Rosato from genetics, from Department of Genetics. In addition, we found that in cry null mutants, so when protein cry is not present, cycling of BRP is not present. So this is normal cycling with two peaks at the beginning of day, beginning of night, but in cry zero, null mutant, this cycling is not present. There is also many other rhythms in the lamina which we have found. For example, the alpha subunit of sodium potassium pump, which is important for activity of neurons, also oscillate during the day and night, and there is this rhythm is endogenous, is circadian, is maintained under constant darkness. And when we repeated the same experiment in clock mutants without mutants which do not have pair protein, TIM protein, this rhythm was not maintained. Another example, very interesting, is cyclic expression of hemoxygenase gene. And this gene encodes hemoxygenase enzyme, and this enzyme degrades heme into monoxide, carbon monoxide, ferrous ions, and also biliverdin. And this enzyme is very important in neurons because it's neuroprotective. And this is a graph showing that this expression of this enzyme cycles during the day and night with two peaks, one in the morning and one in the evening. And we found that this enzyme is very important in the retina, protecting the retina against UV. When we use, and this is another slide, when you use UV light, we found that the number of DNA breaks increased in comparing with control, that when we use hemin, which is activator of heme oxygenase, the number of DNA breaks was decreased. And again, when we use inhibitor of heme oxygenase, the damage in the retina and the UV exposure was increased. It is also very interesting how heme oxygenase control expression of genes in the retina. So here are expression of genes during the day and during the night in the retina. So the first layer of the optic lobe, this is the retina of the compound eye. And red are upregulated genes during the day, and blue are downregulated genes during the day. And during the night, you see opposite patterns. So there is less upregulated genes than downregulated genes. But when we silence heme oxygenase gene, the pattern is reversed. So when heme oxygenase is very low, there is lots of downregulated genes during the day and less upregulated, but completely reversed pattern during the night. And this is also during after a low level, after silencing heme oxygenase genes, after when there is low level of this protein. And for example, we know that antimicrobial peptide are regulated by heme oxygenase, and they are suppressed during the day and upregulated during the night when there is a low level of heme oxygenase. Next questions which we asked was how circadian information are delivered to the visual system. And we found there are two projections from the central clock, and projections in green are clock neurons here, but in magenta, PDF projections and ITP projections, ion transport peptide. So two neuropeptides, which are present in clock neurons, they project to the lamina, probably just bringing information to the visual system. In addition, we found that not only input from the central clock is needed, but also inputs from local oscillation. We call them peripheral oscillation. And this local oscillation are in photoreceptor cells as well as in glial cells. So actually we need three inputs. This is a frontal section through the drosophila brain, and in different colors are group of clock neurons. There is about 150 neurons, clock neurons in the brain, and they are all called pacemaker neurons. So they project to the visual system, but also input from photoreceptors oscillator and from local oscillators in glial cells are needed to maintain circadian rhythms in the lamina. In addition, mechanism of these changes during the day and night in many processes depend on TOR protein signaling and autophagy. So TOR is very important. This is abbreviation from target of rapamycin. TOR is important for many processes in cell. It controls cell survival and growth, and autophagy is a process important for also for cell survival under stress conditions. So both proteins are needed to maintain rhythms in the lamina, but also rhythms in behavior. And here you can see that after silencing TOR protein or ATG1 of autophagy protein, this rhythm in swelling and shrinking L2 monopolar cells, or in the number of synaptic contacts, tetrasynaptic contacts. This rhythm is not maintained after silencing both proteins. And also silencing TOR and ATG affects sleep in flies and affects activity in flies. And both genes, TOR and ATG5, they also oscillate during the day at night. So to conclude, I would like to say that synaptic contacts, interneurons, and glial cells in the fly's lamina show circadian plasticity. Probably also many neurons in the brain show circadian plasticity, but we are just not studying them. Just clock neurons also in the brain, they show circadian plasticity, but we don't know how many more neurons, maybe all neurons, but we just study only a few. And this indicates the morphology of neurons and synaptic contacts are remodeled during the day and night. So our brain also changes during the day and night, completely looks different during the day than during the night when we sleep. Circadian plasticity of synapses and neurons is correlated with circadian rhythm in the abundance of synaptic proteins and several other proteins. And I just mentioned two proteins, which maintain activity of neurons, and second with the second hemoxygenase, which is important in neuroprotection. The rhythm in the lamina are controlled by circadian inputs from the pacemaker, from glial cells, and from circadian oscillators in the retina. And we know that TOR signaling and autophagy are very important to maintain this rhythm. If I have a few more minutes, so I would also like to tell you about my second model, mice. Because I wanted to, with my collaborators, to check if all these oscillations observed in Drosophila brain, in other flies, also occur in the brain of mammals. And another model is mice. And in mice, we examine the number of synaptic contacts, structure of neurons in layer 4 of the somatosensory cortex. And somatosensory cortex, layer 4 is called the barrel cortex because it has little complexes of neurons, which looks like barrel. And they are cortical representation of whiskers located on the mouse snout. So we can find exactly which whisker has a cortical representation in the barrel cortex. And this phenomenon has been detected only in rodents and by Lusley and van der Loo. And you can see one section here, one section from the layer 4 with barrel marks, barrel. So we can exactly examine particular barrel. And we were looking for, this is the sections from light microscope. After making sections of the layer 4, and this is a section made from this section for electron microscopy. This is very thin ultra thin section, and we were looking for synapses located on dendritic spine. And here is dendritic spine marked, and on dendrites. So dendritic spines are small protrusions from dendrites, and we're looking for excitatory synapse, like it's here, and for inhibitory synapses shown here. So excitatory synapses, they, when they are stimulated, will activate neurons, but inhibitory synapses, when they are activated by neurotransmitter, which is released from presynaptic cells, will inhibit postsynaptic neurons. And we are also looking at synapse on dendrites and synapse on spines, on dendritic spines, and found that there are double synapse spines and also single synapse spines. So double synapse spine, they have two synapses, one excitatory and one inhibitory. There is also possible to reconstruct from a Syrian section prepared for electron microscope the structure of a single spine with two synapses located on the spine, excitatory and inhibitory, and you can see that size of and shape of spines can change. Mice were holding special running wheels to record the locomotor activity. And we use C57 black mice, and they are active at the beginning of night, and they sleep in the middle of or almost the whole light. They sleep, or at least they don't go inside running wheels, so they don't run or sporadically during the day. At certain time during the peak of activity, and during sleep, we sacrificed animal and counted in the barrel Cossack synapses, and also examined dendritic spines. What we found? We found that in total there is more synapses during the day than during the night, but this situation was under LD conditions. So mice were held in LD conditions 12 hours of day and 12 hours of night. But under constant darkness, there was more inhibitory synapses when we counted the total number of synaptic contacts. But when we divided excitatory synapses and inhibitory synapses, we found that there is more excitatory synapses during my sleep, but under constant darkness, this rhythm is not significant. But in case of inhibitory synapses, there were more under LD conditions, as well as under constant darkness, more inhibitory synapses during the night and subjective night. And examination of the density of spine showed that we have more dendritic spines under day-night conditions during the day. This rhythm is not significant under constant darkness. But when we separated single synapse spines from double synapse spines, we found that there is more single synapse spines during the day and subjective day, but double synapse spines are in the higher number during the night and subjective night. So to summarize, experiment on mice, I would like to tell that excitatory and inhibitory synapses oscillate in the number during the day and night, But more excitatory synapses is during sleep, which is in contrast what everyone thinks. But there is more inhibitory synapses during rest time. And the rhythm inhibitory synapses is generated by the circadian clock. We know because this rhythm is maintained under constant darkness. And we think that mechanism of these changes is that during the night, just to existing single synapse spines, the inhibitory synapses are added, and we have the during the night and also under constant darkness during subjective night, more double synapse spines. And that's all. And I would like to thank my collaborators and also funding institution. And thank you very much. And I am ready to answer some questions. Thank you.